One, it's my privilege as Chairman Training Committee to welcome the office bearers, Board of Directors, chairpersons of various committees, and distinguished guests. I warmly welcome all of you to the IP webinar series, session 8. I'll repeat the webinar guidelines for those who have joined in for the first time. Your microphone has been muted. Please don't unmute it. Also, your video would be paused, so please do not try to run it. You're requested to rename your joining after joining the Zoom meeting as the format shown. Your Zoom name should be first name and the last name and the company name. Anil ji, could you please mute yourself? First name, last name and the company name so that it's easier for us to recognize you. If you're not getting clear audio, please check your internet connection and also switch off your videos. In case of question or problems, please drop a text at the bottom chat window. All the questions would be answered at the end of the session. The webinar is being recorded for the benefit of our members who have not been able to attend. And question and answer session will be in the end. Please type your question in the chat window. So the past webinars which we have done so far, we had webinars on how to stay digitally connected, man and machine safety, influencer marketing, creativeness post COVID-19, improve revenue and brand presence, Bureau of Indian Standards for amusement park, water park and ISE manufacturers, rebooting our indoor amusement centers. Let's start up with the session today. So today's session is on FRP mold and molding for the benefit of amusement park, water park, ISE manufacturers, as well as users. Now for users, we're talking about how to maintain the fiberglass material which you are using in. Now for this, we have with us today a speaker or guest speaker is Dr. Chaitanya Shah. He's Director Mechamco Resins Private Limited and CEO of Royal Thermostats Private Limited. His expertise, if you talk about, he's an expert in polymer materials and technology, composite materials and technology, analytical techniques, and material characterization and performance evaluation. He's actually a BSc chemistry from University of Mumbai. He's MSc from chemistry in chemistry from IIT Mumbai. He's M.Tech for material science and engineering from IIT Mumbai again, and PhD in material science and engineering from IIT Mumbai. Professional and a great speaker, and the slides he's going to share in today are really going to be a very good and help to everybody who's a manufacturer, small time manufacturer or a large time manufacturer. So may I request our guest speaker, Dr. Chaitanya Shah, to kindly continue with that. Over to the speaker, please.
Hello, good afternoon. Hello, good afternoon to everybody. And welcome to this effort. And I would thank at outset IAPI to organize this to discuss what FRP can do today in the industry, what you represent. So I've chosen a name, FRP, a winning formula for your industry. And let's begin deep dive into today's journey with a little bit of introduction to what is FRP and the features and benefits of FRP. Most of you know, but I would like to brush up things to create a background set for the for the discussions we would be able to have. The first and primary important aspect in any composite business and the use of composite materials is the safety. And in safety, you as a park operators or a park owners, as well as the fabricators, manufacturers of components and parts, everybody has to deal with these raw materials and all. And the third section would be, what would be the suitable material for FRP production? And then the FRP molds, which is the key to success for everything what you see on the you know, at the park for the end users? And what would be the good manufacturing practices for FRP manufacturing is something which I want to go a little bit deeper so that people can understand the implications of good manufacturing practice can lead to a better business opportunities and learning more and creating better and better output. And then I will be showcasing some FRP molding processes and, you know, how that thing is done. And then I'll have a couple of slides on new trends in materials and processes to give you a glimpse of what Indian composite businesses can contribute towards the industry you represent. And then, of course, there would be a question and answer session at the end. So to give you a brief, FRP is a general terminology which is used, technically it is fiber reinforced polymer, but it is used in many different acronym purpose. People name it as fiber reinforced polyester, fiber reinforced plastic, and also term used GRP, which is also a glass reinforced polyester. So technically, FRP is a composite material with fibrous reinforcement in a polymer matrix. And why these are wonder material, known as wonder material? Because they have a specific position amongst all the material of construction in terms of the specific strength and specific stiffness, encompassing the usual need of places where metal like steel and aluminium, wood and concrete, etc. are being used. So you can always replace these materials ideally with composite materials when it is designed in a right manner. And these are produced using a variety of techniques and meeting best of the aesthetics, performance in service life. Also is popular in applications where corrosion, lightweighting, aesthetics and variety of shapes and sizes. Fast track design board to application wherever it is required or in demand, that's where the popular applications are. So for amusement industry perspective, what are the benefits, especially from FRP? So these are having a very optimum stiffness and specific strength range, and thereby it can be made lightweight for the same level of performance as that of the other conventional materials. It can be made into a single one piece complex shape and size, whatever the size could be. So you don't need to do an assembly line if you are able to generate a mold and the product using that simple single piece. So there are resistance is not there because of the system is chemical resistant and the weather resistant. Manufacture and deliver in short.
May I interrupt you, Mr. Chaitanya?
However, this needs little expertise. Yeah, please.
Yeah, I think your audio is crackling in. So if you could just unshare your video, you can stop in the PPT.
Okay.
That will help in the band.
Yeah. Just give me 1 second. Can you hear me now properly?
Yeah, the audio is
clear. Yeah, perfect. So I would continue where I left off. So easy to tailor design, manufacture and deliver in short time is one of the major benefit of FRP, especially for amusement industry where you want a faster turnaround of a given concept and bring it to the use or to the user directly with the, you know, the validation also done. So complex shape and aesthetic built in simultaneously into the system is going to give you a real value for money at the end of the day. Also, these materials are easily repairable and maintainable at to create the matching color, matching finish as and when the damage occurs for any XYZ reason. And thereby, it also has a reduction in operational cost and works fine. Of course, excellent return on investment, depending on, you know, how you are designing it, how your perspective you have created. And of course, there's a one major benefit composite always enjoys is no pilferage or stealing, because these materials are designed for a given application and cannot be resold as, or it cannot be recycled. So it has no resale value. So these are some of the benefits which I perceive makes a difference. So how are these FRP made? So it's a composite material using fibrous reinforcements in polymer matrix material is the general way of explaining. However, you also need to add specialty additives, performance additives to tailor unique requirements, which is related to UV stability, which is related to color combinations, multiple impact effects, abrasion resistance. You want the specific type of flame retardancy in the system, as in the theme park, it is very, very important and crucial to achieve that. And these additives play a major role, like just like spices in our cooked food. So right spices in the right amount gives you the perfect test. Anything in excess or anything in less would not up to the mark. So keeping that thing in mind, there are different ways of processing these materials by hand layup, what we call as a process, by hand process, which is by manual operation or spray up operation. Then there is a resin transfer molding and the variants of it, like LRTM, ULRTM, and then there is an infusion process, and then there is a compression molding, pultrusion, filament winding, and host of other methods of making it. However, one need to know the good, the bad, and the ugly of FRP before you judge and evaluate and use for a given application, which is comparing and competing against the other materials, especially with respect to life cycle assessment cost. So this is the terminology which everybody, I think, is now familiar with. The sustainable business need to have our ability to put everything into the place, right from environmental protection all the way to reuse, recycle, and reduce the cost of the energy and the cost on impact of things on the environment. The good part here is the complex shape and aesthetics it can bring in, lightweight structure, corrosion and weather resistance at the lowest carbon footprint in all the materials produced in the world today. The bad is it's difficult to recycle and disposal at the end of life. So even after having a reduced carbon footprint, it is also required to know how do you dispose it off at the end of its life, which is typically anything between 5 years to 25 years, give or take little here and there as on today. And the ugly part of the FRP is when it catches fire. Unfortunately, these materials are made using organic polymer materials, and these are flammable unless and until they are formulated with certain kind of additives to reduce the fire retardancy. Coming to the fire and those things, and also the health and safety requirement on the manpower, the operators, the users of the raw materials to FRP parts. We are talking about safety in FRP shop now for a few slides, which will give you an idea of what all is key and important. In the time of COVID, we all now are familiar with the word PPE, personal protective equipment. And this is what precisely had been recommended and been used effectively in use of, used in the production area of composite materials. So safety references are typically in material safety data sheet of raw materials brought into the shop, which gives you the guidelines for safety on handling and material handling guideline, first aid measures, handling accidents and spillages, firefighting measures, storage and transportation, etc. So these are very crucial, important information and should not be overlooked by the people who are managing the shop floor, managing the stores, and managing the supply chain. So these things need to be thoroughly reviewed by the entire team to understand what preparations they need to do while bringing the material in, storing it and using it in the process. The safety, the use details in MSDS is, you know, pictorials are given. So these potential hazards are very clearly defined. One need to look at these pictorials into the system. Also, hazardous material identification system is always to be used specific to the material. So you need to know what all class of hazardous index, the personal protective equipment required, and the personal protection index need to be followed. So for resins and gel coats, a typical stuff is major hazardous component is styrene monomer, which is a part of about 30 to 40, 50% in the solution. It's highly inflammable. Keep away from, it has to be kept away from ignition source. Use carbon dioxide foam, dry chemical or water fog to extinguish. Avoid direct contact to skin or eye, hence protecting the, you know, the impact or effect, and avoid direct inhalation. So these defines the personal protection requirement and fire hazard and health hazard requirements. So for personal protective equipment, you need to wear a bodysuit as the ideal, but as and when the people are doing different kinds of work, they need to use whatever is convenient and useful, preventing any kind of accidental impact because of the material. Safety on managing spills and leaks, depending on the size, the quantity, and the nature of these problems, easier way to do is to not to pour water and run it into the drain, because that's going to create more damage. So you need to ensure that inert material is used, like sawdust or a sand or something, and then, you know, disperse the material along with it and then collect it and appropriately dispose of at a solid waste management in the local regulations. Apart from resin, you are also using curing additives into the system, which is typically promoter, accelerator, and catalyst. All of them are, you know, defined here in the safety aspect with the hazard symbols. So promoter is typically very toxic and flammable liquid. Accelerator is harmful and flammable. Catalyst is corrosive, oxidizing, which is also known as explosive in nature and flammable. So these materials, there are very specific guidelines I put down here, which would be definitely be shared with all of you at a later date and at a later time, and you can refer it as and when required. I would move on to the next slide just to give you a flavor of what all do's and don'ts, especially with respect to accelerator and catalyst or any other catalyst compared to MEKP. So very, very important aspect is accelerator and catalyst should never come in direct contact as they create an explosion. So never allow it to come in direct contact. So you need to even store it separately in different corners of your store. And of course, while using it, it has to be used with work separately into the system. Firefighting measures, never use water jet, as that may spread the fire. Small fire, use dry chemical, carbon dioxide and sand. Large fire, use water spray, but not foam or fog it. And after extinguishing, apply water to prevent reigniting. Very, very important. Also for flammable liquids, do not inhale fumes. In case of fire, after a fire, ventilate the entire area, etc., and wash, soak it with water and clean the walls and metallic surfaces. So again, similar kind of spill handling. Release agents are typical liquids, which are again harmful and dangerous for the typical environment. So never empty them into the drain of the when you don't want to use it or excess material is left over. So reinforcements are the non-hazardous in a direct manner. They are not flammable, but they also have materials which are very itchy, especially they form a very fine dust when they are cut or allowed to, you know, grind on the surface. So these need to be protected. The storage is required very carefully. There is a sizing done, chemical treatment, which has a tendency to undergo transformation in presence of humidity as well as moisture in the environment. Suggest again use handling work where you don't, dust collection system should be in place for disposal, and long sleeve clothing should be worn at the time when you use it. And at the same time, one must also wash first with mild soap and then water as a first aid in case there's some itchiness and things happen. And use vacuum equipment to remove fiber from the contaminated surface, including your own personal clothing. Never use compressed air. What I have seen in many places over the years, that people tend to use compressed air, which is available, to dust off the surface and then redistribute those fibers in the atmosphere, around in the air, which can lead to long-term exposure to lung issues. Cleaning solvent and thinner similar to that of solvents, resin and the liquids, the preparation need to be done. Now coming to the next stage of my presentation is FRP production. So FRP production is the key where it need to start, right? Good preparation all the way to getting the end product perfect. So just like prepare everything in advance, and then you get to get then you tend to get the right finished product into the place. So formula for success is defining performance parameters, designing the laminate sequence, selecting appropriate production method, selecting suitable raw materials, and SOP based production and quality validation. So what are the suitable materials to begin with is the gel coats. So we have some typical recommendations for mold manufacturing, which is going to be the heart of your production and quality of the finished product it would be defining. So one of the stuff what we recommend is the ISO NPG based gel coat for the modified ISO NPG based gel coat for open mold. For mesh dye mold, our recommendation is to go with vinyl ester based mesh dye. For product manufacturing, typically good quality product you want to make using the gel coats, so need to be ISO NPG acrylic modified with UV stabilized, and also the another next best alternative is isothelic based UV stabilized. Never use orthothelic based gel coats. They have relatively very poor performance in terms of the weathering resistance, water absorption characteristics, etc. The resin type for hand layup and spray up process, I have classified the requirement on resin from the hand layup and spray up, as well as from the RTM and LRTM, because their characteristics are very different. For mold manufacturing, again, you need to use a corresponding compatible resin to that of the gel coat recommended. And these resins need to be tooling resins if they're available, or it need to be at least a thixotropic resin based on different chemistries, what I described. For the product manufacturing, the 5-star is given to NPG isothelate based resin, thixotropic for working, and isothelate as 4-star, and orthothelate would be the 3-stars. The specific reason is all the materials when tested as soon as the laminate is prepared would show the similar properties because of the glass content, and volume fraction defines the major mechanical properties which are typically used. However, when they are exposed to environments, specifically in terms of different kinds of weathering conditions or use conditions, the differentiation starts, and this can start as early as 6 months. And you can see the materials which are based on orthothelate do not survive long life. So if you are promising something to the user, you must be clear What would be the service life you are offering? Tip for the specific resin type, it has to be thixotropic version for hand lay up and spray up to prevent rundown on vertical surfaces while making the product. The suitable resin type for RTM, LRTM, on the other hand, are typically for molds. You need to use compatible resin, as explained early in the earlier slide. For product manufacturing, again, you have varieties of resin to choose from. The benefit of using vinyl ester and isothelic resin is also already same as that in the hand lay up and spray up type. But even here, you can use orthothelic and DCPD resin, because these resins have a very specific resin formulations to be adaptable on RTM and LRTM process to achieve perfect mechanical properties. To give you an idea, an orthothelic resin for infusion is used by world's largest blade, up to 69 meter length windmill blade, is done in an orthothelic resin, which is of a very specific quality. DCPD resin is another chemistry which has come up in the last 10 years, which also has very good benefits in terms of dynamic mechanical fatigue properties, because it contains less amount of styrene and also has better performance on mechanical properties. So these resins need to be very specifically low viscosity, low exotherm, and fast curing characteristics. There's also a tip at the bottom. You need to select suitable curing system for these resins to achieve faster demolding time. So coming to, you know, what are the basic principles to be adopted for good manufacturing practices for FRP? Adopting robust practices related to hazards and safety standards for all departments, which is very crucial, because everywhere there is a need to have safety principles followed. Adopting and creating internal training qualification for manpower and meet desired set standards for quality manufacturing benchmark. As per your industry standards, the finished product must meet these performance properties. Prepare and adhere to the SOPs of every step of operation, right from material inward to all the way to dispatch of the material, and ISO 9001 methodology would fulfill this requirement. Use of relevant tools and accessories for all operations. Do not shy away from upgrading to a next level from wherever you are to get the benefit onto the system of higher efficiency, better savings, and achieving more value addition in your product. The maintenance related to workshop and the hygiene related stuff need to be clear. This would prevent cross-contamination, also prevent accidents, also ensure the quality of the product is not compromised. In-process monitoring of quality parameters, of course, is going without saying that it has to be done to make course corrective action in case during the production you figure out what can be altered and can be ensured for end product coming out all right. So these are the materials, tools, accessories for FRP manufacturing, which is basic pattern or mold, release agents, reinforcements, curing systems, preparation tools, application tools, etc. Molds, which is one of the important aspects of the fiberglass production. I would be speaking number of slides now to focus on what are the molds, what kind of molds need to be, how you can achieve the best performance to get you the you know, the value for working. So mold is the definition for the quality of the part produced. The mold is giving you the surface finish and the dimensions what you need to have. So quality of the mold is essentially very, very important for mass production. Investment must be right to achieve the maximum ROI. So you don't overinvest into the molds where your requirement for the production cycle is limited to certain numbers, whereas you don't even compromise on the savings for high volume productions, going ahead with the better investment. So material selection and process selection defines the overall cost for the molds, and the life of mold depends on the materials as well as workmanship. So here you need to employ best of your skilled manpower to ensure the molds are prepared in the right material, right process, with the right steps of production. Must aim for good mold to start with, which is good mold to stay with even after multiple cycle of molding, say a good 500 numbers. Maybe that would, you know, really make you wonder, is it possible? Yes, it is possible. It is possible. We have already seen that happen in the industry. So that's where I would share. Coming to one important thing, why FRP molds? It's produce complex shape and size, easy to produce mold with that complex shape compared to metal. Lightweight compared to any other material of construction for making mold. Long lasting when compared to wooden molds. Repair and maintenance, easy to patch and match the surface profile of the mold, and relatively low amortization cost compared to metal molds. So it has all the winning factors to get into making the FRP molds. However, there are many common issues many of us are aware of, which results into the FRP mold quality, which is specifically print through on the surface of the fiberglass pattern, which is poor selection of gel coat, one of the major cause, or the poor workmanship. The second problem is seen is poor dimensional accuracy and loosening of the shape soon after repeated use for 30 to 100 cycles. This can happen if the construction sequence is poor or if performance of the material is also used is also poor. Star cracks on the mold surface, which is the, you know, ban on the composite manufacturer, because every star crack on the mold, he has to do the repair on the finished part. But those star crack appear on the finished part as well. So these are typically because of the inferior quality gel coat and the layer sequence, which is followed up onto the mold. So frequent polishing required on the mold to achieve the same gloss level, same performance from time to time. So that is typically bringing the mold out of your cycle of production, leading to poor return on utilization. So this is typically low hardness and toughness being poor on the gel coat. So I'm going to give you material options for patterns and FRP molds. I'm not going to go into the detail. The highlighted points are pattern materials, which can be POP, clay, wood, foam blocks, tooling board, tooling paste, FRP, depending on the number of molds you want to make out of one pattern. And typically, people use different kinds of strategies, pattern to mold to master pattern, and then the mold, or directly from pattern to master mold, and then make a master pattern out of master mold, and then keep making repeat of molds. So pattern and pattern finishing plays a very important role here, depending on what way you want to go. Release system to be used for creating the same finish on the FRP mold to go onto the finished part. You must use liquid wax or semi-permanent release systems available in the market with varieties of brands and places. Effectively useful and, of course, is economical as well. Tooling gel coats, which are NPG isothelate based, we just talked about it. Tooling resin, we talked about. The important thing I want to highlight is to create stiffening on the back of the mold. Can be done using the core materials by creating sandwich mold, which I'm going to discuss and describe in few slides from now. And also you can use your regular stiffeners by using wood, steel angles, channels, or foam filled stiffeners. And also the stand or a trolley for mounting the mold, either fixing the mold on the trolley or just holding on to the trolley as a stand. And it can be either of the steel or a wooden material with or without the wheels. So preparing the good pattern, you do the you know, suitable pattern material, work to get the desired shape as per design for pattern, then you do the surface finish, which is very important using the high HDT coating system to achieve desired gloss, and then apply the system. Now, FRP mold typically would have three design elements, distinct elements. One is a functional tool surface, which is about 3 to 5 mm, because that need to take all the use and abuse from the functional surface of manufacturing, rubbing, polishing, buffing, also chemical resistance, and the resistance to liquid resin and the heat, which exotherm on the part which is produced would be facing. So functional tool surface is very, very crucial and need to be minimum 3 up to 5 up to 8 mm as well. Then you can do the structural layers, including stiffeners, and then the support layers for additional stiffening and handling of or ease purpose. So mold quality and result must be known, then only you know what you are going to get, and you would be visualizing what you need to have, and then you can work towards it to get that really happen. So tool surface must be very tough and high impact resistant, and must retain surface finish and resistant to chemicals. It should be robust, resistant to scratch and abrasion as a tool surface. Overall structural laminate must be very strong, having high impact resistance, must be free from dimension variation and tolerances, within the tolerances, and then the retained shape and rigidity during use and abuse. So constructing an FRP mold, we have a couple of, you know, the standard norms which practically everybody recommends is the tool surface laminate, which has to have the first layer of gel coat, which is 1 to 1.5 mm thickness, which is specially formulated for achieving this practically zero shrinkage, has good toughness and abrasion resistant and porosity free surface. And then two layers with surface tissue is something what I personally recommend, because that is what is typically done in the chemical resistant equipment also to achieve long life of the process equipment under harsh environment. Same way it can be done here, you use two layers of surface tissue, no harm in paying little extra for extending the life of the tool multiple folds. One layer has to be powder bonded chop strand mat with the tooling resin of a specific weight, 225 or 300, roll it into to remove all the tiny air bubbles so that, you know, there is no air gap between the gel coat and the laminate layers. And then 3 to 4 layers of 450 GSM powder bonded chop strand mat to build up to your required tool surface laminate. So this is what we have, one small set of work here sharing with you. The gel coat application is done on the first, the instance, then surface tissue is applied. Then the powder bonded mat is applied first layer, and then the couple of layers of chop strand mat on the gel coated first layer. The stage two starts with the sandwich construction, core, structural core, which can be senosphere core casting made with hollow microspheres available in the market with suitable cast polyester resin, mix it, make it provable mix, or cast it into tiles and use it later on. And there is another voluminized microbubble, voluminized non-woven core mats are available, also known as sphere core or core mat system, and that can be laminated with polyester resin. So here I have some small demonstration on how these things are done. So typically you apply a little bit of a paste casting putty to fix the core layer tiles. And after application of that, you do it. And then what you see on the right hand side is the core structure applied and kept ready for next layer of lamination to go. So So the last stage is the stage three, where you do the outer layer, outer skin laminate. You can build in all your texture, fixtures, everything you want to do on it. Anything related to, you know, putting different kinds of stiffeners in case you need to put additional, depending on the size of the mold and calculations for sandwich construction. You may still need to go with the higher level of stiffening for large size molds. So this sandwich construction actually helps you create a lightweight material, lightweight mold. The summary of the outer skin is shown here. To layer sequence start to finish. The final summary is tool laminate, structural core layer, outer skin layer. And it's just these materials, the way it is shown here work, there are no glue or bond line in the between the core and the outer and inner skin layers. As you can see, a small cutout shown here describing what is the way the whole mold can work with. There's another one with the core material, sphere core material, how it would look like. So benefits are manifold. Construction can help create desired stiffness and strength without any glue line, bond line, a monolithic structure with no shear failure. So even after repeated use and abuse, the mold would survive. The mold is made in a short time period because this layer sequence can be done very rapidly. Stage one can be completed in 1.5 day. The stage two can be completed in another 1 day, and stage three in another 1 day. So you can have the mold practically ready in minimum 3 days to maximum 4 or 5 days, depending on the size. And the mold surface would last much longer, giving longer life to the mold. So we have seen in the industry where mass production of automotive as well as railway parts, or in terms of special industrial products of multiple use of the mold demands. We have a case history where even 5,000 cycles are completed in RPM mold with a part thickness of more than 10 mm without any resurfacing of the mold. And the mesh die molds, we have supplied something to a fan blade for cooling towers where they have 250 to more than 500 parts before resurfacing was required or maintenance was required. And open mold, endless performance case histories where modular panel, modular components, where flanges on the component need to be of the stable dimension and working to help people achieve assemblies without any problems. So open mold can give you RTM mold equivalent stable dimensional tolerances if the sandwich construction is done. So some of the hand layup and spray up molds look to show there's a matte finish mold, there's a semi-gloss mold and a high gloss mold, all with the same process of construction, what I explained. Coming to good manufacturing practice, even in the mold making, you have to follow the good manufacturing practices for FRP. Adopting robust practices related to hazard and safety standards, which we talked about, adopting and creating internal training, we talked about preparing and adhering, we spoke. I brought this slide back here because we are now going to talk about composite manufacturing, the part manufacturing. And it need to be remembered that as it was necessary in the mold, it's also equally necessary for making the parts. So I have a little bit of things to show you, open mold, the size, the way people need to work, and the manufacturing process. So basic steps of production, mold cleaning, release application, hand layup or spray up, same. Gel coat application for hand layup or spray up, same. Application on the surface tissue. For hand layup mainly, because in spray up it's not typically done possible. So hand layup process is used, then the lamination, then the demolding, then the post cure and finishing. So HL and spray are written for the production process where these steps are implemented, also by the method by which these particular steps can be implemented. So step zero, very, very important step. Why it is zero? Because when you use mold multiple times in a day, you may not need to do this step again and again. It's done once in a while. Clean the mold with a suitable mold cleaner, which is optional. Clean the mold free of dust and dirt. Apply either sacrificial release system or apply non-sacrificial release system, which is semi-permanent. A sacrificial release system is typically wax and PVA, which is the cheapest and still used by many manufacturers around the world. By the way, hand layup is not a process which is dirty, which is not controllable, which is not, you know, it can be general, but really speaking, hand layup is still used in the advanced composite manufacturing, which is like aerospace parts. Each and every part is done by hand layup, by a skilled worker using the skilled worker tools and tackles which are required for their work to be completed. And those guys are given for every step SOP. For every step, one SOP is given, and it's page wise. And they do the stage wise operation, and they have to keep tick marking on the page what they have completed. So you can create a nice SOP for ensuring the people use and follow the same principle like they do in aerospace parts into your regular hand layup parts also. And you can achieve excellent quality parts, reproducible from the team, if this team has also gone through a complete qualification as per the norms similar to those adopted in aerospace to qualify a molder before he's handing over to the shop floor for producing the parts. So there is a typical curriculum people need to go through, which is like a training course for learning the basics of working. So these, some of these slides are typically used in a similar manner for explaining the purpose and how to go about it. So step is to thoroughly wax and polish the mold surface if you are using sacrificial type, which has to be a silicon-free wax, and then you apply PVA, and then PVA application is done, various methods to be used, the steps to be followed very well. The drying of the PVA must happen into the place, and the part need to be produced, and then it has to be cleaned after demolding again. And the PVA must wash away from both the mold and the molding once the part is produced. I am typically going little, you know, short on time. So I would request an additional time if the moderator permits me, about 15, 20 minutes more.
Yeah, Dr. Chaitanya, I think the subject is going very intense, and the intensity of it and looking at the detailing of it, I think we'll have to go ahead. So, dear guests, please be sure that we'll take another 15 minutes for the session to continue in from Dr. Chaitanya. And then I have lot many questions lined up. So, probably we can take, say, around 25 minutes from now, we'll be ending up the session.
Right. Appreciate it. Thank you. I would try and maintain the speed now.
Please, okay. Please. Thank you.
Right. So, coming to the, the release systems which are non-sacrificial, semi-permanent type. There is a certain sequence of application which is typically shared by the supplier of the semi-permanent mold release, which is depicted here in the repeat cycles and use. Just need to follow that as per the recommendation. The gel coat application, which is done behind the application on the surface release application, is the first layer of catalyzed gel coat on the mold, either by brush or roll or even by spray. And then you allow it to tacky dry. Gel coat must cover the entire mold in the first layer. And the second layer of catalyzed gel coat is then finally applied, which must be generating the final gel coat thickness, and as much as possible, it should be uniform throughout. So this is typically true for the brush or roll type. If you do spray application, typically you do wet on wet to the total thickness built up in one go. Typical gel coat thickness depends on the requirements of the part, where it is used, what purpose it is used for, and how to go about. So this particular presentation is talking about in general. So you need to define your own gel coat thickness. It could be anything from 400 micron minimum to up to 1,200 micron or 1,500 micron, as in the case of mold making. Application of surface tissue, which is very, very crucial. In that, you need to apply the catalyzed resin first on the gel coated surface, which is almost tack free, and then you need to apply or dab. Pre-dabbing is done. You don't, place it randomly. It is to be pre-cut into the shape and size into the mold's requirement, and just dab it into the catalyzed resin. It's a very fast wetting system. The surface tissue provides high quality finish and durability in chemical environment. The care must be taken not to allow fold of surface tissue, because that can lead to air bubble entrapment. So skilled working is extremely important. So person who is applying surface tissue has to be knowledgeable how to do that. The next layer, before you apply next layer, it should become tech-free or tech-free cure or techy dry cure. Lamination, everybody in the production has been aware of. However, I would like to put one very important point here, that you don't put dry mat onto the surface tissue laminated mold surface. You first apply catalyzed resin, and then you roll first layer of chop strand mat into the resin system, not over the, not applying resin over the mat. It has to be CSM into the catalyzed resin system, and this would ensure no air bubble entrapment. And then you do subsequent layers, either you go wet on wet or you tacky dry and then apply the next layer, depends on the layer sequence, the thicknesses you need to work with, and how do you go about creating this kind of right exotherm control. Consolidation of each layer is very, very important, so you must use suitable roller to do that. The lamination further in the step four is further layer of resin and reinforcements are applied ongoingly. Apply at the end of the job 3 to 5 mm with the surface tissue, which is again optional depending on your layer sequence and the working which has been decided. And once it is done, you may do the trimming of the edges using a sharp cutting tool. I personally don't recommend that, because that has a tendency to create a dimensional mismatch when the part is demolded. When you have a trim edge created onto the mold surface, it is typically at more than 90 degree or more than 60 degree angle on the mold. So that creates a natural stiffening and restrain on the part edge, ensuring there's no warpage of the part happening. Then you do the demolding, allow the mold part to cure inside the mold, few hours to few days. Again, it depends on what you need, what you are making. And if you need, you can also speed up the curing by heating the laminate while it is in the mold. And there are various strategies, including, infrared heater or UV bulb to assist with the extra heat on the surface, or mold itself having the heating arrangement to help you with a faster cycle, which is typically done for RTM molds. Then you do the demolding. Always ensure you use wedges but not the screwdrivers to demold the part, because that would scratch the mold surface. These wedges can be made in-house or can be bought ready-made, which comes along with air gun. to push the wedge below the between the surface of the part and the mold. And you can use compressed air with pre-designed ejector valves or pins. Then post-curing and finishing. Very, very crucial, very important. Post-curing is required because even with the best of the resin and best of the curing cycles and the best of the skill, curing occurs only up to 90 to 95%, even when you think your barcode has reached. Typically, this happens because of the immobility of the cured material in the matrix as and when it undergoes solidification from liquid to gel to solidification. And those trap the unreacted monomers, not yet completely or fully reacted into the system. And they slowly go into the system and react further, and otherwise they leave the surface and go away, leading to some amount of shrinkage, which can be detrimental on a very tight tolerance parts. So how do you avoid this happening is by doing a post-curing. Typically a post-cure is done when you take the part out from the mold and put it into the jig fixture of the specific dimension stability, which is very rigid, and subject it to heating. Heating can be done externally, or it can be done by putting it in a heating oven, air circulating heating oven kept at a particular temperature. The post-curing has to be done as per the resin supplier's recommendation, which way it has to be used. If it is done external heating, an infrared heating system has been successfully implemented. After the post-curing is done, the piece need to come back to ambient temperature before it is removed from the fixture or the mold or whatever place it is and handled, ensuring that after that the cleaning and finishing and trimming operation can be done. So this is in brief about what I had on manufacturing. Now, few of the latest trends I would like to speak about in FRP materials and processes for amusement and recreation industry. So there are design optimization tools now available for what you call FEA analysis, and then virtual analysis to ensure that you don't end up with the poor quality, and you can do very tight material designs with less excess of material used as a safety factor. And they can interface with the material performance data directly, because a lot of data is generated in the industry, which is now captured and used by these design tools. Then you have advanced resin and hybrid reinforcement systems with zero or low shrinkage tooling systems, flame retardant systems, high fatigue life endurance in all weather conditions. Then we have nano reinforcement materials and nano additives available into the resin as well as in the reinforcements. Closed mold production, very limited number of production units are adapting to the closed mold production because of the want of investment and the quality of the skill available inside the industry is what I see is the problem. But this is what you need to adapt to over a period of time and become used to the new systems and working. This particular system provides enhanced two-side finished products, has much better thickness control and the dimension tolerance control, allows easy and faster assemblies because they are properly matched with the dimensions. Also, use of mechanized tools to highly automated robotic operations, and they can achieve faster production with very high accuracy and tolerances, including material consumption. So there they can save all the way up to 15 to 20% of material, and the minimum amount of variations in the part to part consumption. On a couple of videos I have, even it says that on a 25 feet hull, the yacht or a boat, there is a variation of only 50 gram of gel coat consumed when it is applied with the robotic arm. Only 50 gram of difference when from one mold to the other mold to the third mold. You know, it's fantastic. So now you can have control over your costing, your understanding on your material consumption and planning. So everywhere you can have a huge amount of saving when you adapt to mechanized tools and automated robotic operations as the ultimate level. And of course, the 3D printing of composites already been put into the use. A lot of successful stories are available. You can check out few on the YouTube or on the net. And these are direct design to product prototype for validation and testing. There is no mold making required. There is no part production required through various production processes. It's just straight, AutoCAD drawing straight onto the printer. You have glass fiber reinforced, carbon fiber reinforced, suitable resin to go with, and they've been able to make actual size parts directly for testing and validation. And of course, you can do tailoring of product for every customer project. If you use 3D printing, you can do minor modifications which are desired by the customer for a given project. So a couple of small examples I'm giving you here. In an RTM mold on the extreme left, you see the mold being filled with the reinforcement and materials, core, etc., into a complex shape and a geometry which is large enough. And then the counter mold in the middle picture, you can see, is being brought towards the mold to close. And the finished part, which has been brought out, has, as you can see, a complex geometry with a lot of sharp corners and multi-steps. And everywhere the thickness is varying. It's not constant thickness. And there is another technique, what we call it as ultralight RTM molding, the large size silicon bag project, which is done as a reusable flexi mold on the top, can be used for making parts as large as a boat and with minimum handling mechanism requirement as compared to RTM. So this is something which I would ask you guys to really dwell on and think about how to go about. So this is my contact. Anybody wants to reach out to me can use this. And I would use this time again to thank you all for patiently listening. I hope you guys could get something out of today's presentation. And I look forward to question answer session and tell moderator to take over. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chaitanya. Thank you from my side, and definitely on behalf of all the participants who have been attending in the show today. It was quite intensive and quite elaborate. So I have a lot many questions lined up. So probably I have selected few, and probably I'll be compiling up a few with each other so that you can answer in one go. And then I'll be taking in probably two or three live questions also. Which you can answer in directly to them. So the first question is from Mr. Pradeep Sharma. I'll just take 1 second to get into the question. Yeah, is there any UV-proof pigment available in India which can be used for FOP gel coats?
When we use something in a gel coat, UV-proof is a very good way to look at it. Pigment alone is not the contributing factor for the UV stability. It's also the base gel coat also makes a very important role. And they both combined as an impact has on a UV stability. So it is better to go with a formulated product with a very specific color, which you need to use from the manufacturer. Then the onus is on manufacturer to ensure it is there. And there are capable manufacturers in the industry here selling in the market, where they can give UV stable gel coats with pigment. And certifications can be always done about, let's say, 500 hour of UV exposure, 1000 hour of UV exposure with delta E measurement to know the fading or the yellowing impact on the pigmented gel coat.
Okay. So next question is from Mr. P.K. Basak, but I'll not be taking his question right now. He has multiple questions. So probably at the end of the session, I'll ask for a live question and session in which I'll take Mr. Basak's question. So next question I'll take is from Mr. Ajay Chawla. Sir, can we use UV on finished molds? I didn't get the question exactly, but if you can answer that.
UV on finished mold. It's a little difficult to understand, but I, as I understand, maybe he's looking at can we use UV protection on the finished mold.
Yeah,
if it is so, yes, it is required. Typically, all tooling gel coats are UV protected. And also, typically, the top coat used on the mold is also has to be UV protected. So when you buy something, when you purchase something, I understand these molds would be kept outside in the open. Yeah. Being a very large size, cannot be stored under the shed, under the shed, or always covered. So UV protection is very, very important and must be there on the formulated products.
Okay. So the next question I'll take in from Mr. Anup Taparia. For exporting products to USA, is there any compliance issue due to high inflammability?
Typically, Anuki, you need to know every customer or a buyer has a specification which you need to follow. And those specifications are very, very clearly defined as what part and product it need to be. So on shipment, the as a component is not defined as a flammable unless it is torched or directly put into the flame. So it is not a hazardous mass or a hazardous product. So it can be shipped as a non-hazardous product, but it has to be sufficiently protected from a direct exposure to fire.
Okay. So the next question I'll take in from Mr. Pradeep. Is it advisable to make gel coat from resin? If so, what additives are there to do so?
Yes, very good question. A lot of people have asked me this question. The important part to remember is gel coat is akin to your skin to the body. As your laminating resin is supposed to make a bone for your body. So skin and a muscle are two different aspects. So skin need to have a certain characteristics which muscle cells can't give. So laminating resin has, the elongation at break not more than 2-2.5%. Whereas the gel coat must have minimum 3% elongation, preferably up to 4-5-6% elongation to achieve the right performance. Also, gel coat must also have very good reactivity, control, so that it gives you cure even with the thin film, which is not possible with the laminating resin material. And of course, a gel coat is not just thick resin. Gel coat is also a formulated product with varieties of additives. Like when you want to make, very nice, dal, the curry, you have to put multiple additives or spices to make it taste right. So similarly here, you have to put a lot of additives. There are more than 12 to 14 additives which would go into making a gel coat if you have the right base resin. But definitely it is not the laminating resin can be used because that would lead to, surface behavior to be poor on use.
Great on that. Next question I'll take in is from Mr. Shirish Kumar Joshi. Which is good material for water park slides, FRP or RPI?
I don't understand. What did it say? FRP
or? Which is good material, RPI. I'm not aware of what is RPI.
Maybe something to do with thermoplastics. I'm also not very sure. So if he can
okay,
find
I'll
the
do
question
one
and
thing.
come
May
back,
I
yeah.
request the host to unmute Mr. Shirish Kumar? Host, kindly unmute Mr. Shirish Kumar. Host?
Yes, doing that, sir.
Yeah. Shirish Kumar Joshi.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Mr. Joshi, what's your question exactly?
Generally, for water park slides, in India, FRP material used, but in imported slides, they are using RPI. RPI coating they are using. So FRP is good or RPI is good?
When you say coating, is it actually, you know, it's only a thin layer on the part or because this
it's a layer on a slide. Part.
It's a layer on a slide. So this is actually a after production coating or an in-mold coating would be done with a nano material, typically with the maximum thickness of some few hundred microns.
Okay.
If I understand clearly what you mean, it has been used in many new applications people have come up with. However, with the FRP, you can't compare the two because even an RPI need to go onto a surface. So would it be a rather good quality gel coat or an RPI coating is what I would answer it as. Typically, good quality modified acrylic modified ISO NPG gel coat would give you an excellent water resistance, excellent UV resistance, and excellent chemical resistance to cleaning chemicals, which is typically, you know, bleach compounds and other stuff which are used in water pool and other purpose during the use in the water park. So
yes.
NPG isophthalate resin with the proper modifications is one of the most ideal gel coat. There are further variations available in the market, which is also known as, you know, the nano additive modified. So that gives you a mechanical strength also to the material, further improving the performance of the gel coat film, which is say 600 to 900 micron, specifically for water slides.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Right.
Thank you. So the next question I'll take in is, how do you measure in the strength of a fiberglass molded piece?
No, how do you? Sorry.
Measure the strength of a fiberglass molded piece.
Measure. How do you measure the strength of the fiberglass molded piece? Very good question, because everybody need to know whether they have made the things which is coming right or not right. So one of the technique typically used in process industry where you cannot make a cutout of your part just and waste it. So typically there is an extra space made into the mold to make a coupon at the time when you are making the part. And you continuously do that coupon simultaneously either on a side of the mold or onto the part itself in a designated area through the same material what you are using. And this coupon can be say 300 by 300 or 150 by 300, and it is going through the same curing sequence, working sequence, and then you take that piece out, cut it, carry out your dimension requirement specimens out of it, and test. You cannot test curved pieces, you cannot test overall working piece for the mechanical testing as it is, unless it is demanded for. So there are certain design requirements, certain validation requirement of the part that the whole piece is subjected to destructive testing with the specific type of jig and fixture. But for the qualification rounds on the laminate sequence and design validation of your overall structure, you need to plug in the values of your laminate. So this laminate values you test and then plug it into your design software, calculate the strength required and arrive at the right thicknesses. So that is cross-validation and acceptance of the part what you made. So this could be a very good thing for consultants to approve because you have everything available with you to justify what you are giving is the right product.
Okay. So the next question I'll take in from Mr. Santosh Kumar. How to remove the scales regularly from FRP rides? Can we use diluted 1% HCl?
Typically, removing the scales is a major issue because these scales generate from varieties of environmental pollution or exposure, including the inside the water park. When you drain the water out of the park completely for cleaning and purpose, leave it open for a while and then again refill it, you see the scales coming up. These kind of scales need to be first analyzed. What is the from where it has originated from and what is the reason of being there. Second thing you need to do is a small test, because your slide may be already gone through certain aging cycle. It's been established use for 1 year, 2 year, 5 year, 10 year. So surface of that slide is already aged. And based on that aging concept, you need to do a small trial work. Typically, a good gel coat, if it is used, let's say ISO-NPG based gel coat is used, then definitely it would be easy to clean with hydrochloric acid solution. But if it is not the right chemistry gel coat, then you would have a problem of damaging the surface, not just removing the scale, but you would be damaging the surface for further use. So it's always subjective to first a small trial on a non-essential or non-critical area to verify whether that process works.
So I'll just add in a word to it for Mr. Santosh Kumar to understand him. The scales normally which we have as, we understand, and normally when we use slides, water which is used is got chlorine. Now, when you leave the slide at the end of the day, you leave it with the same water. Now, the water evaporates by the next day, and the chlorine gets deposited onto the surface of this thing. So it is always advisable to wash in the slide at the end of the day with fresh water. And the water quality also need to be checked in. What is the type of water, whether it is a hard water or a soft water. So that is what I'd like to add onto it. The next question I'll take in is Mr. Karan Menon. What should be done if stars develop on the mold of rides? Also, if we have scaling on the fiber molds of rides, how should we clean?
Typically, this built up what he's talking about on the mold surface is either a wax which is built up over a period of time. If he's been using if somebody is using the wax PVA as a work, or sometimes styrene also polymerizes and builds up on the mold surface. So this need to be cleaned with a certain standard procedures, which typically recommended for this purpose is polish it using fine paper, starting with say 700 or 1000 grit. Remove all the rough surface area and then clean it with mold cleaner, which is a very special formulated blend of solvents suitable to dissolve wax as well as dissolve styrene or polystyrene into the system. And these solvents do not, they are not like acetone or a thinner or a cleaner solvent typically used for resin cleaning. They don't clean the surface. At the end of the cleaning process, you need to go through the again the polishing, buffing and rubbing compound process to achieve the gloss and go through the release application systematically. So this is a very intense and elaborate work and need to be done only by the skilled manpower, authorized and understanding to use this kind of process so that you don't damage your mold beyond what it is already.
So Dr. Chaitanya, I think there is still one part which is left out. Of the question, what should be done if stars develop on the module of rides?
Star cracks are developed on the module, then you have no choice but to grind off that top surface of the mold and rebuild the surface using resurfacing procedure. So there is a standard standard procedure of creating resurfacing on the mold. And these need to be done typically if there are multiple star cracks. Don't do patchwork. You remove the total top layer, go all the way to the first layer of glass reinforcement. Then you apply a primer coat, which is supplied by the resin manufacturer, and a top coat, which is equivalent in performance as that of the gel coat. Because now you are applying it as a top, not on a pattern surface, you are doing the layup sequence. So you are doing the reverse process. So there is a special top coat as a resurfacing coat on the mold. And that resurfacing coat, you once it is applied properly, you do the cleaning and polishing and rubbing, buffing, and you do the gloss what you need. And this mold, if it is done proper, can again last you many cycles, provided the structural layers behind that is robust. And typically the star cracks happen because people tend to hammer the mold from the back, and when the mold surface is not thick enough. So one of the suggestions to the team here who is present to consider sandwich construction mold, so that the hammering is not going to damage the tool surface. And typically all polyester resin parts are having a shrinkage, and they tend to release very easily if the draft angle, corners, and the things are taken into account at the time of designing the part and at the time of fabricating the mold, so that you don't have to actually, fight with the mold to release the piece. Also, you can create ejection system into the mold to prevent such kind of difficult situation and then damage to the mold onwards.
I think this is a question asked by a lot many people. So everybody's answer remains the same. So I'll take a next question from Mr. Ajay Ruya. Can you build in copper tubes carrying coolants in FRP wet slides to make it icy and slippery in snow rooms?
Interesting question. There's nothing comes to my mind that I have seen such kind of work being done by anybody, but I don't see why it cannot be done, because it can be done in mold. Heating and cooling channels are made in a mold, but then the construction sequence, the expansion coefficient difference between the copper tube and the FRP which is surrounding it, and thermal conductivity of the FRP material need to be looked at. I am sure it can be done, but a lot of engineering would be required, because standard design norms would not work here. A lot of change in the materials and change would be required. So it is possible, because heating and cooling of FRP surface is already established into an RTM mold. So we need to work around this. They can talk to me offline at a later date with specific requirements. I would be able to help.
Okay. So I think I have a few more questions lined up, but I think time is a major constraint. So I'll just take two live questions. Mm-hmm. May I request to switch on the video and audio of Mr. P.K. Basak? AV of Mr. P.K. Basak, please.
Yeah. Good evening. Dr. Shah, can you please tell me what is the shelf life of ISO resin or ISO gel coat?
Okay. Mr. Basak, typically a resin manufacturer decides what he would like to give a shelf life as. Shelf life is dependent on multiple factors. And one of the factor is storage temperature, the place where it is stored. As a resin manufacturer's standard practice in India is minimum 3 months, subject to riders such as storage temperature is below 25 or somebody says below 30 degree. Also the storage temperature, away from the sunlight, and it's stored in the original pack, original containers, so that there's no contamination once it is open. If you want to enhance the shelf life of the material beyond those months, you may probably would need to do the aeration. So that process is available, can be shared by whoever is the supplier of the resin you talk to. They can give you the return procedure and you can follow it. So typically, formulated products, shelf life, like a gel coat material with very special conditions and special use, may have only 2 to 3 months, whereas resin can be anything between 3 to 6 months, depending on your working and storage conditions.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome.
May I request to switch on AV for Mr. Balwan Chawla, please? Mr. Balwan Chawla.
Dear training chairman is not in the training session.
He's
another meeting.
Okay. So anyways, may I request the host to kindly update the members about a session which we have, an exclusive chat show tomorrow on Amazon Park. Its heading of the chapter is Unlock the Potential. May I request to kindly share the screen, please? So friends, this is a session which we have tomorrow. May I request everybody to do login. You can go to the site, register yourself on the web for the webinar. The industry people will be speaking about it. It's going to be a very useful and very successful session. May I request everybody to do login and join in for this webinar for tomorrow. We'll continue with the session now. So we had a great question answer session, and now it's time to thank Dr. Chaitanya Shah. Thank you, doctor, for the great insightful and deep knowledge shared with us, and hope that the guests have taken away handy, helpful information and would take full advantage from the efforts taken by the great speaker in compiling and sharing best practice for the amusement industry. Thank you once again, Dr. Chaitanya.
Anuji and the team at IAAPI, I am very happy that I could be a part of this program. I really appreciate all the efforts, and thank you very much for sharing all the questions. I'm sure whatever pending questions are there, we would definitely take care of these if these are passed on and forwarded to us. Thank you. Have a good evening and take care.
Thank you, Dr. Tanya. May we request to upload the feedback form, please? Friends, about the topics, please do mention which topic you'd like to cover up. We have tried to cover up different topics. So your advice on this would be definitely very helpful for us to understand and more on what exactly you would like to learn more about. And we'll choose the speaker and the subject accordingly. So going ahead with it, now the next session again, which will be on 25th, we have it from Mr. Rajan Shah, Shape Your Destiny. It's such a wonderful session. I have attended it before, and that is why I have tried to bring it again to you. Those who could not attend it earlier can attend it. It's a wonderful session. And with that, I would extend my sincerest thanks to all guests in today's webinar. It is solely because of your interest and participation that the webinar series has continued to attract such numbers and has become a useful platform where ideas, knowledge, and experience can be shared in. It is not only the speakers who share in the experience, even your experience you can share in. You can just mail it to us. You can drop in a message to IAP. You can share it to